Our first speaker this morning is Tom Mitchell, and as you know, Tom is the President and CEO of Ontario Power Generation. He was appointed to that role in April of 2009. He has over 35 years of nuclear experience. Before joining OPG, he was Vice President of the Assistance Division of the Institute of Nuclear Power Operations in Atlanta, Georgia. During his career there, he managed the Radiological Protection Plant Analysis and Engineering Support Departments. He served as the Deputy Director of the Atlanta Center for the World Association of Nuclear Operators. He was involved in WANO activities in several parts of the world, including CANDU plants at Bruce, Darlington, Pickering, Point Lepreau, Chernavoda, and KNPP. Now, as of January 1st of last year, Tom is now also the chair of the WANO Atlanta Center Governing Board. By virtue of that appointment, he is a member of the WANO Governing Board in London. He was also asked by WANO to chair and lead a special post-Fukushima commission. And in 2012, he was also appointed to the board of directors of the Electric Power Research Institute. And last year at this conference, we heard from Tom speaking about the Fukushima Response Commission. He also delivered a presentation on WANO's and the industry's response following Fukushima. This year, we have the opportunity to learn from Tom about the safety measures that OPG has implemented at its nuclear plants following the Fukushima nuclear event of 2 years ago. He's also going to offer observations on the nuclear industry's evolving approach to nuclear safety. Please welcome Tom Mitchell.
Good morning. First off, I'd like to recognize the CNA and the CNA staff. I think Heather and the team have put on a fantastic conference, so let's give them a hand. It's been almost 2 years since Japan experienced a series of earthquake-induced tsunamis that wreaked havoc across that country. And one of the places most impacted was the Fukushima nuclear plant. And last year at this conference, I argued that the nuclear industry will emerge from Fukushima a better and stronger industry. And I believe that's happening. Since the event took place, many of us in the industry, us in this room, throughout the world, have added new equipment and developed new procedures to strengthen our safety margins. We've also participated in extensive drill exercises to test and improve our emergency response, completed major engineering assessments of our facilities, including structural, seismic, and high wind assessments. And we've joined others in the industry to share ideas, solutions, and expertise. Many of us have toured the Fukushima site to see what has happened firsthand. And I myself was at Fukushima last November, and many other OPG nuclear executives have been to Fukushima as well. And let me tell you, all of us who go to Fukushima, we come back different. At my visit, I was struck by how much still needs to be done, even after almost 2 years. You know, because the tsunami was so destructive, it's going to take decades for the area to fully recover. I believe it will recover. And there are very impressive efforts by over 12,000 people working to clean up the site. But there's also the human impact of the event. Between 150 and 210,000 people in Fukushima region alone had to be evacuated. And to this day, many of these people are still living in temporary housing. When I think of these things, I realize that Fukushima is one of those watershed events that not only significantly changes the way our industry looks at nuclear safety. But I think equally important, it's also changing how the public looks at nuclear safety, looks at us. And that's what I want to explore today. The impact of Fukushima, not just on us, but on them, the people and the public we serve. Because of Fukushima, I believe we're going to see two things happen. In fact, I believe they're already happening. First, people will become increasingly intolerant of the prospect of taking shelter or being evacuated from their homes in the event of a nuclear plant emergency. They've seen the disruption caused by Fukushima. They've seen the impacts of events like Hurricanes Sandy and Katrina. They've watched and read about the forest fires in California and Alberta, and the BP oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico. They don't want to be part of that. And this is often how they feel regardless of the technology's public safety performance. No one died from a radiation release at Fukushima. And in contrast, thousands of Japanese died from the earthquake and the tsunami. And again, I would just ask all of us to just pause a moment and reflect on the tremendous suffering of our friends in Japan. But try telling that to people evacuated from their homes. It's cold comfort. They're frustrated, they're angry over the disruption the event has caused their lives. And I don't think we can blame them. As a result, people want assurance that nothing like this will ever happen to them from a technology. It's now becoming, in my view, part of the social license to operate. The second thing I believe that is happening is people's risk tolerance has narrowed. They're no longer as willing to accept the view that because something is unlikely to happen, it won't happen. The tsunami that hit Fukushima was not expected to happen, and yet it did. People sometimes call this a black swan or the long tail on the curve. Many of you probably know this expression. It's a highly improbable, unpredictable event that produces massive consequences. The fall of the Soviet Union was a black swan, the rise of the internet, 9/11. No one expected these things to happen at the time, but they did. So instead of asking ourselves how likely it is that something will happen, the public, I believe, wants us to ask ourselves, can it happen? And if it can happen, they want to assume us to assume it will happen and take the right measures to control the outcome. I just don't think anything less is going to fly. So what Fukushima has done then, I believe, in my opinion, is to reveal a fundamental truth about the interaction of people with technology. And I believe this truth is that people's expectation of technology changes over time. It's not static. What was once acceptable can quickly become unpopular and perhaps even intolerable. When I was young, above-ground testing of atomic weapons was not uncommon. Today, nobody does it, not even North Korea. That's an extreme example, but it serves to underscore today's changing expectations. The growing discomfort with evacuation or quarantine, the awareness that we must guard against not just a probability of something happening, but the mere possibility of it happening. I believe these are both examples of evolving public perception with respect to nuclear safety. And it's not just the nuclear industry that has experienced this phenomenon. It's happened in the automobile industry. Think of seatbelts, airbags, mass recalls. It's happened in the food industry. Think about food labeling and E. coli. It's obviously happened with tobacco. It happened with the steam engine, which I mentioned last year here at this conference. In the gas industry, the 2010 gas plant explosion in Middleton, Connecticut, had a direct impact on public opinion in Ontario and helped influence the debate on where to site gas plants in this province. It's also happening in the airline industry, as we're seeing in the case of Boeing's Dreamliner passenger jet. This is a very highly sophisticated aircraft. Each one is priced at $200 million. It's never caused a fatality. It's never even been involved in a disaster. And yet, since mid-January, all 50 planes worldwide have been grounded until they can fix problems with the plane's batteries. I don't know if this would have happened 30 or 40 years ago. But as I said, people's expectations change. Standards become more demanding, and industry and technology have to adjust. And this is where, I think, the nuclear industry does a very good job. We're a mature industry with a mature technology. We've had experiences adjusting through our whole history to changing expectations. For example, we've had to rethink our assumptions in the wake of earlier nuclear events. These include the big events like Three Mile Island and Chernobyl, and also others like the Browns Ferry fire and Davis Bessie. Not to mention September 11th, when the terrorists flew over the Indian Point nuclear plant, prompting a huge reassessment of security safeguards. Each one of these incidents and more have left us as an industry, has led us as an industry to adopt new practices, apply new technologies, establish new codes and standards, analyze new hazards, erect new defense barriers to enhance the safety and security of our plants. So when the time came to respond to Fukushima, we could draw on that wealth of experience gained from these other events. And I believe that this made us more flexible and able to adjust quickly. But it did more. Our past experiences have also made us humble. They have made us aware that we did not have all the answers, we're not perfect, and we could make mistakes. And, you know, it's interesting to remember the days of Atoms for Peace and nuclear power being too cheap to meter. You know, in the early days of our industry, almost everyone was caught up in the promise of this new technology. But the honeymoon didn't last. It rarely does with technology, any technology. TMI taught us, and Chernobyl confirmed, that we could no longer take people's trust and confidence for granted. We had to earn confidence every day, and we must continue to earn it every day. Because in today's post-Fukushima world, people's expectations continue to change. So how do we do that? How do we earn that confidence? The answer lies in how seriously we take people's concerns, how we react to criticism and opposition, and how we allow people to question us and how honestly we answer those questions, and what processes we use to engage, inform, and listen to the public and to the community. It's all these things and more. And I think this is where the Canadian nuclear licensing process is a tremendous benefit to our industry. Unlike the U.S. system, it doesn't require interveners to be under oath or subject to cross-examination. I think that's a huge inducement for people to come forward and freely and openly express their views. Very democratic. OPG recently went through two such hearings, one in March 2011 for a proposed new build initiative, and the other this past December. We listened. We learned a lot about what the community thought of us, about our industry, about nuclear safety. In our view, the whole experience helped build mutual trust and respect and kept us aware of what people expect of us. But you know, you have to do more than just listen. You have to hear them and take what they say seriously. You know, it's not always easy to hear criticism. Tendency, human nature, to dismiss it or be defensive. But a mature industry, like a mature person, can handle it. Our industry has had its share of criticism. But I think one of the things that define us, and we've learned this the hard way over the years, is our ability to absorb that criticism and take that cold, hard look at ourselves and admit that we need to change. I was thinking as I was listening to the last conversation about that shackle hitting that guy in the chest. And he just keeps on going. Absorb that blow. But self-criticism and self-questioning is something our industry does very well, I think. And we need to keep doing it, and do it frequently if we want to keep pace with changing public attitudes. The other thing that's going to earn us public confidence, aside from facing up to the issues that concern people, is to actually do something about it. And in the 2 years since Fukushima, the Canadian nuclear industry has done a huge amount of work to improve the safety margins at our plants and facilities. And just as an aside, I was in that context, I was really happy to learn that one of our own, Ken Ellis of Bruce Power, has recently been appointed to the World Association of Nuclear Operators as its new managing director. And anyone who knows Ken, probably many of you in this room do, will know that his appointment represents a major contribution to nuclear safety in the post-Fukushima world. And I also want to mention Don McKinnon. I'm not sure I see Don in the room. I know he was here yesterday, president of the Power Workers Union. Don has been a passionate advocate for safety, for nuclear safety, throughout his career. And I was really happy to see, very deservedly, he was named to the Order of Ontario, the highest honor in our province. And so I think we're very fortunate in Canada to have people of this caliber in our industry, and let's give them a hand. Meanwhile, on the regulatory side, the CNSC has launched many important initiatives. Just go on its website and look at the Fukushima timeline of events and actions taken, and you'll see what I mean. Yes, we still have more to do as an industry, but we've acted quickly on Fukushima. And I would argue that we must always act quickly when confronted with the need to change. Because public expectations, as I said, are not static, they're dynamic, they're fluid, and we have to be ready to respond to them as they emerge. If we continue to do these things, listen to people in a setting that encourages openness and transparency, acknowledge their valid concerns, recognize our own areas for improvement, not get defensive, take actions to address the issues at hand, and above all, understand that the expectations of people have of us will always change, I think we're on the right track to maintaining and strengthening the confidence people have in this industry and this technology, because they are the hallmarks of a mature industry, tested, sometimes chastened by experience. And I think they can actually help newer industries as well. This includes alternative energies like solar, wind, and shale gas, which also rely on a high degree of public acceptance. You know, there does come a time for all technologies when the public enthusiasm wanes and the bloom goes off the rose. And when that happens, you can look to the Canadian nuclear industry for positive evidence of how to restore, maintain, and continue to improve confidence. A final area where we can enhance public confidence in our industry is in emergency preparedness. Our industry works with many players in developing emergency response plans to address a potential event, however unlikely that might be. And I think it was another great example of that was the Huron Challenge Trillium Resolve drill last fall, involving Bruce Power, Emergency Management Ontario, and others. You know, working with governments and others, we can leverage this expertise to strengthen nuclear emergency planning that is sound, practical, and scientifically up to date using the lessons learned from Fukushima. Let me conclude with an observation. A few weeks ago, someone came into my office and showed me a photograph of the executive management team at Ontario Hydro, which was OPG's predecessor, and the picture was taken about 1950. You know, a black and white photo. And you look at that photo, the executives were all men, all white, and almost all of them were smoking. And when I saw it, just like you did, I laughed. And it was a laugh out of disrespect. Because I knew today you'd never see a photo like that. You know, if you took a photo today of OPG's management team, you'd see men as well as women, people of color and diversity, and no one, I mean no one, would be smoking. And I think that's true for many other companies as well. You know, that's how people's tastes have changed. You know, what was acceptable and natural for people 60 or 70 years ago is not acceptable today. But here's the kicker. What are people going to say when they see a similar pictures of us 50 to 60 years from now? What's going to make them laugh? The fact that no one has a visible tattoo or body piercing. The fact that we're all wearing suits. The fact that many of us do not have perfect features, which by that time may be commonplace through DNA modification. Could be that there aren't more people smoking, because as it will be well known, in 2050 they invented the safe cigarette and everyone started lighting up again. The fact is, we don't know what people will find funny or odd about us in the future. And that's the point. There's only one thing that is certain. What's considered the norm now will probably not be considered the norm then. Public tastes and expectations will change. We just don't know how they will change. And my example that I gave about that is, you know, we are an industry that works in decades. So anything is possible, which is why it's so important to keep listening to our publics, to keep being aware of their concerns, to stay flexible and prepared, to be humble, and continue to acknowledge our flaws, and above all, be ready to act, adapt, and change, as we have done so often before. And I know that if we continue to do this, we'll find practical, effective solutions to meet society's expectations of us. And we will continue to operate in a manner that ensures the safety, security, and health of the people we serve. And this industry will then continue to remain a viable, lasting, and valuable contributor in a world of constant change where anything can happen and often does. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. If you have questions for Tom, he's going to be in the smoking area just outside the building. You can ask them now. We do have microphones available, as always, so just put up your hand and we'll get to your questions. We've got a question in the front here and one right there. Go ahead, sir.
I'd like to thank the nuclear industry for what I think is a prompt and appropriate response to incidents like Fukushima. There's another black swan, though, I think we should address, which is the Stuxnet computer virus. Mm. So I'm wondering how Ontario and maybe the rest of Canada has implemented policies to, you know, prevent cyber terrorism from affecting us.
Well, it's an excellent question, and It is an area that we've done a lot of focus on and a lot of looking, obviously because of the events that have occurred. One thing that was mentioned in the introduction is I'm now a member of the Board of Directors of EPRI, and it's an industry-wide effort, not just in the nuclear industry, but throughout the power sector, to look at the implications of cybersecurity. And I think one of the things that, why I think it's such an excellent question, is that one of the things that is changing is we're becoming a much more connected and wirelessly connected world, which offers tremendous benefits to society, but also poses some risk. So I absolutely agree with you. I think that's an area that has got a lot of attention, increasing attention recently, and is one of those areas that we need to make sure that we have everything in place to keep separation between the systems that control our plants and our grid, and the ability that we all now have to much more directly connect to things. So, thanks, great question.
We had a question in the second row here.
Good morning, Tom. Brian Fehrenbach with CANDU Energy. Thanks for the talk this morning. You mentioned the need for us to shift more from considering the probability of events happening to the possibility of them happening.
Correct.
In order to do that still, we still have to conceive of that event happening, which means we have to be able to know, foresee it, to rank it, and list it. How can we get to a headspace where we're able to consider the things that we don't know or can't predict, or things that we would classify as an unknown, and prepare to mitigate those as well?
Thank you very much. That is that's an outstanding question, because what I tried to describe to you is what I think the public perception is, but I think you've asked actually the question that we need to ask as professionals. You can't predict everything. So that's why, to me, the industry's response to Fukushima, which has very much been driven off a flexible response, and having available to us ways of dealing with almost anything that comes up. So my view would be we should spend probably less time trying to analyze what can happen and spend more time putting into place very flexible, dynamic ways that can deal with any situation. So for example, I think many of you are aware at OPG and others, we've bought a lot of portable equipment. We're storing it away from the station. In North America right now, there is a plan being put in place to establish three regional centers, including one in Canada, where additional equipment would be stored, so that in an event, particularly that would cause damage in the area around the plant, that there's an ability to bring to bear what needs to be brought to control, cool, and contain the reactors.
Any other questions? Just put up your hand if you've got a question. There's right here in the front. We'll get a microphone to you. Put up your hand now if you do have a question, and we'll get the microphone to you so we can get to you right away. Go ahead.
I was pleased that you mentioned Don McKinnon of the Power Workers Union. And what I raise is the question is that I would say he and the Power Workers Union have been the most positive, most active speakers in behalf of nuclear power in Ontario. Is there some reason?
I might disagree with you on that. I think we've done a lot to communicate. And I think one of the things that you need to realize is that there are many forms of engagement. So what we've been focusing on, as well as the advertising and the informational types of things, which you can find on our website, is a lot of personal interaction, where we meet with people, we invite people to come and visit our facilities, to look at what we do, to meet our people and to see the facility and to get a firsthand look. And, you know, whether or not that changes their public position on things, what we do know that when we bring people to our facilities, no matter where they are, they leave with a different view. And so that maybe not as visible as a full-page ad in the Globe and Mail. I would argue that all of those things together are a very effective way of educating people with an interest in this technology.
It's a question right there.
Tom Ron Oberth of OCI. The industry used to use the term as low as reasonably achievable in the way it manages risk. For example, in the auto sector, if we limited speed limits to 30 kilometers an hour, I know we could cut auto deaths down to in a third or down to almost zero. I think if our industry aims for an absolute risk-free world with zero consequences, we will design ourselves out of existence. So the question is, how do you think we can achieve the balance of what's reasonably achievable in terms of anticipating and mitigating consequences and also keep us as a viable technology that moves society forward?
Well, again, I certainly am not advocating or do I think it's achievable to ever get to zero risk. I don't think there's any technology that doesn't have some risks or consequences associated with it. What I am trying to say is I think we need to be very much to try to stay in tune, Ron, with people's perceptions and what their expectations are. And I think whatever the form of technology you've just, and I gave you several examples, I'm just saying that that changes over time. It's not static, it's dynamic. We need to listen to that. And we need to make sure that what, in terms of, if you think about the whole purpose of this conference in terms of what we're trying to do is to talk about dialogue that builds trust and confidence. So I think my general answer to your question is what we want to do is want to make sure that people have trust and confidence and are comfortable with what we do. And to do that, we need to listen and we need to adjust.
Any other questions for Tom? Okay, we have time for one more right here.
Jed Popovich from Canadian Nuclear Society Council. I have a question about rampant NIMBYism, not in my backyard. How do we really respond to that? Not only nuclear industries, and other technologies as well, including highways, other plants, and all other technological achievements. How do we really get the social conscience going and gain the confidence of public?
Well, NIMBY or acronyms like banana and other things that one can talk about, you know, the only way that you can deal with those issues is to engage people. And you know, we at OPG like to think that we do a good job of engaging the communities in which we operate. I travel all around the province. We operate from the Manitoba border to the Quebec border, well past Kapuskasing, which was mentioned this morning, in the north. And in every community that I visit, what I find is that the trust and confidence is built because, in many ways, from OPG's point of view, because of the trust and confidence that they have in our people. And the fact that our people are very strong supporters of the local community, they're very engaged in the local community, and that we are an actual people face to a very large company. So I think you earn that one location at a time, one day at a time. There's no magic formula. But what I've tried to outline in my speech are really those steps. Listening, actual hearing, doing something, and then just realizing you don't do that once. You have to do that all the time because people's expectations and needs change.
All right, thank you, Tom.
Just, It's hard work. It's hard work.
Okay. Once again, Tom Mitchell. Thank you, Tom.